this week is about being, recognizing him as the loudest voice in our lives. And I want to show you something. This is, I still have one of these. it's a clock radio. And it actually plays music pretty decent. And I use it, well, I use it to wake up mostly. But we're going to try to do something. Hopefully it works today. But, we understand radio waves. They come in, and then you get the music, and, that's how it works. I mean, there's nothing connecting this to some big place where the music's coming from. It's through the air, the waves in the air that we can't see. But then there's a lot of things in our lives that want to get in the way. There's a lot of things that crowd out different noises. Things get noisy and crowded. And things in our lives, we're really busy. And so what I'm going to do, hopefully this will work like it's supposed to. I am covering it up with tinfoil because it is supposed to get in the way of the reception and the clearness of the reception. You can still hear it, but it's a little getting more garbled. Yeah, you can't hear it as well because there's so many things that get in between us. This tinfoil, there's a lot of it here, got in between the radio waves that are coming in and blocking the sound on that radio. And I'm going to have to unplug it so I don't have to hear it. Keep going. But that happens in our lives so much. We can only listen to one thing at a time. Sometimes you'll get two radio stations and they just clash. They'll be too close together on the dial. Trying to listen to my husband while I'm going over the sermon sometimes makes it very hard for me to concentrate on what I'm doing. Either I want to concentrate on the sermon or concentrate on my husband. I can't do both at the same time well. I can pretend I do, but it doesn't mean I'm doing a very good job of it. I end up with a lot of distortion and frustration. And so does he. To tune in, this a lot like that little girl in the story that comes up to her dad. He's reading the newspaper. He just got home and he's relaxing, sitting down in his chair, and he's got his paper and he's got his feet up. And his little girl's just about 3 years old, 4 years old, and they talk all the time, right? And they're always talking and they're always asking questions. And she talks to her daddy and she says, after a while she'll go, are you listening to me, daddy? And he'll say, well, and he'll, mm-hmm. And he'll keep his paper up and he'll keep reading along, and she'll go talking some more, and then she'll say, daddy, are you listening? Mm-hmm. And he'd done that about 3 times, and the little girl, she knew what was going on. So she gets up, she climbs up into daddy's lap, she pulls down the newspaper, and she says, daddy, are you listening to me? And she looks in his eyes, and yet she had his full attention. That's what listening is all about. We've got to focus on the voices that are important to us. We can't let everything get in the way. When you want to focus on somebody, when you want to listen to somebody important to your life, you've got to put away the paper. You've got to set the dishes aside. You've got to give them your total attention. For God to become the loudest voice in our life, we have to tune into his spirit and his direction for us. We've got to keep our spirit open so that the Holy Spirit can do his work and become the loudest voice in our life. We allow all sorts of things to interrupt our reception of God and what he wants us to hear. God told the people of Israel from Jeremiah 29, he said, if you look for me wholeheartedly, you will find me. I will be found by you, says the Lord. I will end your captivity and restore your fortunes. I will gather you out of the nations where I sent you, and I will bring you home again to your own land. For the voice of God to be the loudest in our life, we have to value God. So what gives God's voice value in the first place? Well, we value God because he values us. He created us in his image. We are his creation. He is the one true God. He is the only God. He is holy. He is just. He is love. He is truth. We value all those characteristics. And God is the perfect example of all those traits. John wrote, anyone who belongs to God listens gladly to the words of God. But he was talking to these people. He said, but you don't listen because you don't belong to God. John 8:47. To value God, we must have a relationship with him. And to have God as the loudest voice in our lives, our relationship with God must be our highest priority, our highest pursuit, and our highest passion. To put God as our highest priority, we've got to remember the greatest of all commandments and put it into practice. To love the Lord your God, and you probably all can say it with me. We say it a lot here. We love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. That's what it means to put God first in our lives. That makes him our highest priority. When something is a priority, we put it on our calendar, right? We don't want to forget it. It's important to us. I finally learned to do that. I was running into problems of double booking myself, trying to be in two or sometimes too many places at one time. And I would forget about appointments and things I had met. So I finally, actually the district superintendent helped me with my schedule. And he said, you need to do something about it. And so I got on and I finally figured out how to use the Google Calendar great on my computer. And I put the app on my phone. And then right now I put on reminders that ding and remind me of things that I've got to do. Or I have alarms set so I don't forget the things that are important. Now, Tuesday last week, if you still have to put the thing on your schedule. And I forgot one of those. Tuesday morning, while I was at camp, I got a call from Plainview Nursing Home that said, it is your turn to do the service Thursday afternoon. Camp got over it Thursday morning. So I had some work to do. and so I scrambled, realizing I had forgotten to put it on my calendar. I tried to find another pastor to do it in Plainview. And of course, everybody's gone on vacation. And so they all were too. I couldn't find anybody that could substitute for me on such short notice. So Wednesday afternoon, I got that taken care of. And I told the kids Thursday morning, we got to leave right after the set. We got to move it. And they did. They were great. All five of them had their stuff ready to go. We were on the road by, 10:30, 10:45? So we made it. We had lunch and we got here. And actually, I was very glad I went. God really blessed that message. That was the biggest crowd I'd had at the nursing home in a year. So it was really good. And it was fun to sing the hymns after a week of kids camp, too. But it was a good time. But we make time, we make appointments, we put things on our schedule that are important to us, right? I mean, that's those things that are a priority. And so if we want a good relationship, we need to make that a priority as well. I mean, just think, if you're with your spouse or your partner or your best friends, if you only gave them an hour a week or an hour a month, what kind of a relationship would that be? Not a very good one. God asks us to have a relationship with him, to make him the top priority in our lives. Most of us agree that we can certainly work on all our relationships. It is hard to prioritize those people in our lives that are important to us. But for us to have a relationship with God, and to hear his voice, he has to be our highest priority. When we value something, we do make time for it. No matter how busy we are, we can find time for those things that are truly important to us. We are such a busy culture. There's so much going on. There's so much noise and voices around us that we can't always discern the good from the best.
For tomorrow, I know all those school girls and boys will wake bright and early. They'll rush for their toys and then, oh, that noise, oh, the noise, 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 noise. There's one thing I hate. All the noise, 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 noise.
Noise, I mean, that's how I feel sometimes. Sometimes it just seems like there's so much going on, it's just overwhelming. And you may be thinking, well, that's easy for me to say. I mean, I'm the pastor, that's my job, is to get close to God and have a good relationship with him. I mean, I'm supposed to just sit in my office and pray all day. Well, that isn't how it works. I mean, I do understand being so busy that you feel like you're meeting yourself coming and going. There are mornings when I struggle to get any time with God done. There's laundry to do. There's gardening to do this time of the year. I know I'm supposed to ride my horse more. I'm supposed to dust. I'm supposed to do a bunch of stuff. And there's only so many hours in the day. And what I've learned to do, which doesn't mean it always happens, is it's on my calendar now. The first thing I try to do every morning is I do set some time aside for God. And he deserves more. He deserves everything. And I do desire to have a relationship with him. And yet he is so patient, so ready to listen and to hear us. He makes time for me. I need to make time for him. He needs to be our highest pursuit as well. What are you after in this life? What am I after in this life? What are you living for? Our highest pursuit must be to hear God and follow him. He alone holds our every day and every minute in his hands. He has a plan for us. Jeremiah 29:11 says, "For I know the plans I have for you," says the Lord, "plans for a future, not for good, not for a disaster, to give you a future and a hope." He knit us together in our mother's womb. He created us for a purpose and a plan. That's the God that we have. He created us anew in Christ Jesus. Are you pursuing God? To pursue God means we go after him, no matter how difficult it is, no matter how hard it is. He doesn't hide himself so that we can't find him. He hides himself so that we can discover the mysteries of each day. You know, think about it. Every day if you wake up, say, "God, what adventure do you got today? What's going to happen today?" He wants us to seek him in everything that we do. Corey Russell writes, "A father doesn't try to prove his superiority by hiding the Easter eggs in an impossible-to-find place. He hides them so his kids will experience the excitement of the search and the delight of the discovery. The same is true of hide and seek. The point is to be found. Our father is no different. He wants us to experience the excitement of searching for him and the delight of finding him. God hides to be found." Hide and seek is a fun game. That's one of the favorites of most kids. When we were kids, they would come over to our place to practice softball, and a lot of times the kids didn't get picked up right away, so then we would all go playing hide and seek in the dark on the farm. That is a blast because nobody can find you, especially if they aren't on your farm. So, but you know, you would go and hide, but you didn't want to be hidden forever because it got dark out there. You didn't know how long it would take. But you would search them until you found them. And if they didn't find you right away, you'd start making some noise, or you'd start, you know, making some clues or some way for them to find you, because you hide to be found. Because if you get caught, then you get to be the next one that's it, and you have to go find people. That's the fun part. What if someone, you know, hid so well that nobody ever found them? It's pretty frustrating. Or if you hide you give up after like a minute, say, "I quit." We've had that happen here when we're playing hide and seek, and it's really annoying because there's kids out there hiding and they quit before they hardly start. And though it isn't much of a fun game, God is the same way. When he sees us seeking him wholeheartedly, he will point us in the right direction. He will make sure that he'll give us some clues. He'll encourage us. He'll help us to find him. Our sole focus should be to seek God and watch him uncover himself in miraculous ways. But imagine playing that game, like I said, and somebody gives up after just a few minutes. God is the same that way too. Some people serve God for 6 months wholeheartedly, and then they quit. 2 years, 10 years, 30 years, and then they get tired of seeking him, and they get tapped out. But the whole point of our salvation is to live a life seeking God, and to find extraordinary joy and treasure, not just in seeking him, but in discovering his will for us and his direction for us, all the mysteries of each day. We can't grow weary and tap out because our wonderful and miraculous God has so much more for us to see. If we continue in our pursuit of him, God will show us even more. We need to begin every day with a prayer that young Samuel prayed that night. "Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening." Along with being our highest pursuit, God must be our highest passion. In the 1940s, the opinion was that no one could break the 4-minute mile. No, it was humanly impossible. You know, the fastest 4-minute mile so far had been 4.01. So they had tried and tried up till this point, and it just couldn't be done. Well, Roger Bannister is a clear example of somebody who demonstrates passion in running. He just knew it could be done. So every day he worked to build his endurance, to build his speed, And eventually, on May 6, 1954, he broke the 4-minute barrier with a time of 3.59.4 minutes. So as part of his training, he relentlessly visualized beating that clock. He knew he could do it. And after him came 24 more athletes that could also run faster than 4-minute mile. And I don't know how many can do it now. I'm sure there's even more. But a Christian life without passion is like a river without water. Passion energizes the Christian life. It was passion to follow Jesus that made Peter step out of the boat one very stormy night. And this is a great illustration of passion and of making God the loudest voice in our lives. And I'd like us to read along with Matthew 14, 22 to 33. Immediately after this, Jesus insisted that his disciples get back into the boat and cross to the other side of the lake while he sent the people home. After sending them home, he went up into the hills by himself to pray. Night fell while he was there alone. Meanwhile, the disciples were in trouble far away from land, for a strong wind had risen and they were fighting heavy waves. About 3 o'clock in the morning, Jesus came toward them walking on the water. When the disciples saw him walking on the water, they were terrified. In their fear, they cried out, "It's a ghost!" But Jesus spoke to them at once. "Don't be afraid," he said. "Take courage. I am here." Then Peter called to him, "Lord, if it's really you, tell me to come to you walking on the water." "Yes, come," Jesus said. So Peter went over the side of the boat and walked on the water toward Jesus. But when he saw the strong wind and the waves, he was terrified and he began to sink. "Save me, Lord," he shouted. Jesus immediately reached out and grabbed him. And he said, "You have so little faith," Jesus said. "Why did you doubt me?" When they climbed back into the boat, the wind stopped. Then the disciples worshiped him. "You really are the Son of God," they exclaimed. Now, this passage immediately follows the feeding of the 5,000. So they had just seen this awesome miracle that Jesus multiplied the bread and the fish, and the crowd was just ecstatic. I mean, this crowd had been following Jesus for quite a while, and they were following to get something. I mean, unfortunately, the people were following Jesus to be healed, to get food. I mean, they saw a free lunch. They knew what, you know, they were following Jesus because they wanted to see something and get something from him. In fact, in John, it records that they wanted to make Jesus king. So this crowd was there. So Jesus he saw this happening, and he said, "Disciples, you need to get in the boat and get out of here. I need you to leave." Because he was afraid that these disciples might get caught up in the crowd and the mentality that was happening. So he sent them across the lake. And a terrific storm stirred up, and those poor disciples are afraid. Did I get off my place? Nope. Did Jesus know a storm was going to happen that night? He knew they were going to be facing a storm. Jesus had sent them on ahead knowing there would be a storm that night. Remember, Jesus knows everything. He knew that this was going to happen. He sent them, but he knew that the danger of the storm was less than the danger of the crowd that he was sending them away from. The mindset of the crowd wasn't God's will. It wasn't Jesus' time to become king, and that was the wrong thing. And he was afraid that the disciples might be caught up in the tolerance of the crowd instead of the truth of God and Jesus' mission here. The crowd always values tolerance above truth. God's voice will always move us from tolerance to truth. The crowd will always lean toward tolerance instead of leaning toward the truth of God's word. We all struggle with this. I mean, all of us are pretty tolerant of the sin in our own lives. I mean, we think, it's okay, God won't care, he loves me. We know other people won't worry about it. I mean, everybody's doing it. It can't be wrong, because that whole crowd, you know, all the crowd thinks it's okay. So, you know, we tolerate a lot of things in our own lives, even though we know they're wrong. Those sins that might make us fit in. Our culture has come to the place that tolerance is valued above truth. It seems that we can't even disagree with the culture, even when it's wrong. And we must all agree that everything is right. Saying everything is right is like saying that they're only winners and not any losers. And that can't happen. I mean, today, I assume the Twins are playing today. Somebody's going to be a winner, hopefully the Twins, and somebody's going to be a loser. There's not both. It can't all be winners. It doesn't work that way. When truth is sacrificed on the altar of tolerance, it might seem like everyone wins, but in fact, everyone loses. When we value tolerance above truth, we hear less and less of God's voice. God calls those that follow him to a higher standard than tolerance. It's called truth. God's voice will always move us to truth. For us to know his truth, we must keep the source of truth, God's word, ever before us. It has to be our guide. God's voice cannot be the source of your strength if the world is the source of your standards. For God's voice to always move us from tolerance to truth, the Bible in its entirety must be the source of our standards. If we aren't willing to listen to everything God has to say, we eventually will not listen to anything he has to say. And if we want to hear his comforting voice, we have to be ready to listen to his convicting voice as well. Remember, it's often what we want to hear least is what we need to hear the most. The disciples didn't know they'd be in a storm. No, they were clueless. They were thinking, we're going to get across here, go across. We're going to dock, get a nap, get some rest, and wait for Jesus. They had no idea what their future was going to be that evening. And here they are. They're far away from land, and they're fighting heavy waves. A terrible storm broke out. I mean, these guys are seasoned fishermen. And it says they are terrified. So it had to be quite a storm. And they had no time to think of anything right now but trying to get from point A to point B without drowning. That was their thing. Every sinew in their arms and their back, I mean, they're bailing water, they're trying to keep it headed into the wind. Their sole thing is to get that boat across the lake. And about 3 a.m, someone sees like a ghost coming across the water. And they aren't sure what it is, and they holler, "It's a ghost." And they see this. Maybe they thought it was a grim reaper, and this is their last, you know, they're dead. I mean, they're on their way, and it's coming to get them. I don't know what they thought other than they said it was a ghost. And Jesus said, "Don't be afraid." Now think about that. It's windy, it's raining, there's waves, and they could hear Jesus across the water say, "Don't be afraid." They heard God's voice. God's voice demanded their attention and a reaction as well. God's voice moves us from fear to faith. No matter how terrifying the storms in our life, it's always safest to turn to Jesus. Turn your fear into faith and trust. Jesus' first words to the disciples were, "Don't be afraid." That is one of the most repeated commands in the Bible. It is said that it is written out 365 times in Scripture. Don't be afraid or fear not. So, I mean, that obviously it's important. I mean, you could take one for every day of the week, every day of the year, and just say, "God doesn't want me to be afraid." Fear is the number one reason people avoid doing what God asks them to do. We're afraid of what the crowd may think or say or do. We fear how hard it'll be to do the right thing. We fear the truth, because the truth is difficult. Think back to a time when you felt afraid. Who did you turn to? What did you turn to when you were afraid the last time? Did you turn to your spouse? Did you call up a friend? Did you turn to a bottle? Did you turn to some other drug, something to make you quiet down or feel better? I mean, I remember some movie, I remember, guy said was taking a drink, and this little girl asked him what it was, and he said, "Well, I was getting some courage." And she goes, "Courage doesn't come in a bottle." And that's the first place we should turn is to Jesus Christ. First place we should turn is to God and call out to him and say, "I'm afraid. I need some help here." God wants us to turn to him first. When Peter realized it was Jesus, he called out, "Lord, if it's really you, tell me to come to you on the water." And Jesus said, "Yes, come." So Peter, it's just amazing. He gets out of the boat, he crawls out, and he starts walking on the water towards Jesus. He You know, just picture that. I mean, the storm is going full blast. The other guys are still in the boat, and he's walking on the water. That'd been so cool. But then he looked to the left or the right, and he saw the wind and the waves, and he got scared. He let the fear overrule his faith, and down he goes. I mean, I'm sure he thought that was going to be the last thing he'd remember. And then he called out, "Lord, save me." And Jesus did just that. He grabbed him and pulled him out. And Jesus said, "You have so little faith. Why did you doubt me?" Peter was willing to face his fear. I mean, at least he got out of the boat and he was walking on the water. That was pretty amazing. Peter took the first step. When we step out of the boat in obedience, God will bless our obedience and we can save ourselves a lot of heartache. But don't forget those other disciples. Where were they? Where were the other 11 disciples? They're in the boat. Nobody else got out. They all stayed in there. They stayed with what they knew, what was comfortable. They knew, you know, in their minds, if you get out of the boat, you drown. Our only way of salvation here is staying in this boat and getting it across. They weren't willing to take the chance. They weren't willing to risk it. They let their fear, it was more comfortable to stay in what they knew. You know, and that happens to a lot of families that have, that addicts come home to. It's just the families. I have a friend that's struggling with that now. She's starting to put her life back together, but nobody is ready to help because they're afraid. And one of the things is that they're afraid. They're afraid that if they get too excited about it, it'll come crashing down again. But it is the familiar. I mean, they say it's very difficult for an addict to come home because the family often has not changed. They are still practicing all the same things. And it is hard to change. And for it, the addict is all clean. They've learned new habits. They've learned new coping skills. They have got clean and they're doing well. But their family, that's something different. I mean, it's hard to change. And, you know, they don't want to change their lives just because that guy has to change his. And so they stay familiar. They stay where they are. They're afraid to change, to make a difference in their lives. And often, there's a lot of breakups during that time, no matter how strong the relationship might have been. There's a separation often after that addict gets clean and comes home. And in our heads, we know it shouldn't be that way. But then if you think about all the changes that might be facing that family, you can see possibly how that happens. To be successful, everybody has to change, not just the addict. I mean, it's so easy to stay in the familiar instead of getting healthy. Change is hard. Change is scary. So they opt to stay where they are. For the recovered addict to be successful, there has to be a lot of changes in their lives and in the lives of people around them. These disciples knew fish and boats. They knew what they were doing. They were pretty sure they had they were going to try to get across the river, the lake. So they opted to stay in the boat instead of experiencing walking on the water with Jesus. I don't know. I hope I would be brave enough. I mean, I'm scared of water. I would have a hard time. But I hope I would be brave enough to be like Peter and walk towards Jesus. That would just be so awesome. God's voice also moves us from regret to reconciliation. Jesus admonishes Peter as he saves him out of the water. And he says, "Why did you doubt me?" You know, Peter's probably feeling like this big because he doubted Jesus and he feared and he fell in the water. Peter was walking on the water and he took his eyes off of Jesus and he looked and he saw the wind and all the old fears took over and he lost his focus and he sunk like a rock. At that moment, Peter recognized that he had blown it and he was smart enough to say, "Lord, save me." And Jesus took him by the hand and rescued him. We have all failed to pursue God at one time or another. We have let the storms in our life, the voices of the culture, move us to distrust and lose sight of the truth. We begin to follow the crowd and let our fears defeat our faith. When that happens, we can cry out, "Save me, Lord," and he will always come to the rescue. As we have accepted Christ as our Lord and Savior, when we pursue him and make him the highest priority, we are children of God. We are called to live holy lives. We are called to live in truth, and it says the truth will set us free. some of the signs, I mean, some of the ways that we show our faith and we live it out is by being baptized, which we will do next Sunday. The sign that we are one with Christ in death and one with him in life. When Peter went under the water, I'm sure he thought, I'm dead. This is it. But he called out to Christ, and Christ raised him again above the water. Well, that is a symbol that we do as baptism. When we go under the water in baptism, it is saying that we are dying to our old selves, we are dying to sin, and we are being raised up into new life in Jesus Christ. Galatians 3, 26 and 27 says, "For you are all children of God through faith in Christ Jesus. And all who have been united with Christ in baptism have put on Christ like putting on new clothes." Next Sunday, we'll be celebrating baptism. We will be celebrating all that have recently made decisions to follow Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Those that desire to do that, we'll, you know, have them talk to me, or we'll talk about it. Or even if you want to recommit your life and make a decision and a stand. It's saying that I do believe that Jesus Christ died for me. I accept his grace, because it's only through his grace that we can be set free. Baptism is one way that we pursue God with all that we have, by making a stand and saying, I am a believer. I follow Jesus. Our relationship with God must be our highest.